Hello, I'm Dr. Joel Palmer, the Curriculum Science Coordinator for the Mesquite School District. I'd like to take a minute or two to talk to you about the LabPro equipment and the LoggerPro software you have available on your campus. This is the Vernier LabPro equipment that you should have on your campus. If the box has never been opened before, it should look something like this. In the middle compartment is the actual LabPro data interface. This is a device that takes the data from a probe, translates it, and sends it into the computer. You'll notice that it has three buttons at the top. We will almost never use these first two buttons. They're designed for use with calculators. You may occasionally use the start-stop button. On the left-hand side, you'll see that there are four data inputs. And on the right-hand side, you'll see two data inputs and then another set of inputs here, and these are the inputs to connect it to your computer. There is a little sliding door that goes back and forth, and when we get the cables out, I'll show you why that is designed like that. In the right-hand side of the box, you'll find two pieces of strangely shaped plastic. These pieces of plastic are designed to allow you to hook the LabPro to a calculator. The LabPro fits on the back of the device. The calculator fits on the front of the device. There is a small cable included that serves one purpose and one purpose only, and that is to connect the LabPro to the TI-83 or 84 calculator. We don't use the calculator in middle school. First of all, we don't have them at the middle school. Secondly, they're really not as user-friendly for middle school students. There are two little buttons on the side of the LabPro that you'll never use because they're designed to allow you to take the frame off. So collect the two frames, collect the cables, and throw them away. Those are not needed. That's all that's in the right-hand side. In the left-hand side, there's a whole mess of cables. What you'll discover is two long cables. The first one I want to talk about is a data cable that has a trapezoidal shaped plug on it and a round plug, and a little short cable that has a round plug and the mating plug to this one. These were designed for computers that had what were called I/O ports and for the Mac I/O port. They plugged into the side of the LabPro. You slide the little slider towards the bottom and the round adapter plugs in. None of our computers anymore use any of these in or out ports. So these two cables, the little one and the big one with the tall heads, can be thrown away. Trust me, no one has any use for those, so putting them in a box in your storeroom is just going to take up space. Throw them away. The other long cable has two USB plugs on it. One of them is a traditional flat USB. The other is a D-shaped USB. This is commonly found on printers and scanners and devices like that. By sliding the little slide to the front, you get an open USB port, you can plug that cable into there, and you're ready to connect that to your computer. Also in the left-hand side, you'll find a piece of cable that has a white connector on it and a red and black set of connectors. These come with every LabPro, and these are voltage detectors. So if you were teaching about electricity, which we don't in the middle school, you would use these to measure voltage and amperage and that kind of stuff. Like all Vernier probes, they have a plug on the end of them, and the plug fits directly into the side of the LabPro. Now, there are two kinds of probes with the LabPro. There are analog probes that go into the left-hand side. There are digital probes that go into the right-hand side. You might ask yourself, how do I know if this is an analog or digital probe? LabPro, Vernier Company, is very smart. This probe will only fit on this side. If I try to plug it in on the other side, even though the plugs look very similar, they are not identical and it will not fit. So if it won't fit on this side, I want to turn it around and it fits on this side. The last thing that you're going to find in your box is your power adapter. The Lab Pro is designed to work off batteries. It will hold four AA batteries, but batteries eventually get used up. They're expensive to replace. It comes with a power adapter. You simply plug the power adapter into the lower left-hand corner, plug this into a wall outlet, and you're good to go. Most of our data collection will be done next to a computer in the lab. The power adapter will be fine. There are situations where you might want to collect data not connected to the computer. The Lab Pro is designed to allow you to disconnect it from the computer, take it into another environment, hit the start-stop button, collect data, come back into your lab, reconnect the computer, and download the data. In that case, you will need a set of batteries, but for most of what we're going to use this for, the power adapter is what we want to use. One of the activities that is in the curriculum is a hiker lab from Laying the Foundation. And for that lab, you're going to need what's called the motion detector. Some of you have motion detector 2, others of you have motion detector 1. This device uses sound waves to measure the distance between itself and another object. It is a digital detector, which means when I go to plug it into the Lab Pro, if I try to plug it in on the left-hand side, I can't get it, it won't fit. I know to plug it into the right-hand side, and I'm ready to collect data. One of the nice things about the Lab Pro device is that it's very simple to use and it's very simple to connect to your computer. You can launch the software first, or you can connect everything up and launch the software afterwards. Logger Pro should be installed on all teacher and student computers. Its icon looks like a little caliper on a red diamond. If you don't find it in your toolbar, you simply need to go under Applications, scroll down to Logger Pro, and run it from there. When Logger Pro first opens up, if you don't have a Lab Pro plugged into your computer, you'll get just a basic blank screen. Now let's connect your Lab Pro to your computer. Step one is to plug in the power. And when you plug in the power, you'll hear it beep. That's perfectly normal. You don't have to wait for the beep. Next step is to take the D-shaped USB and plug it into the side of the Lab Pro. Once that's done, take the other end of the USB and plug it into any USB port on your computer. You're good to go. Once you're running Logger Pro, if you plug in any of the probeware, Logger Pro will recognize what probes you have and immediately change your screen, creating graphs to collect the data that that probe will produce. If I plug in additional probes, you'll notice the screen changes again, and I can now collect data on two different probes at the same time, and it's already set up the graphs for me. You'll notice right now your graph has no axis units on it. It just has an X and Y. The Logger Pro software detects any probes that you install and immediately changes the graphs to record data from that probe. So if I take the Sonic Ranger or the motion detector and plug it into the Lab Pro, you'll notice the screen immediately changes so that we have two graphs, one recording velocity and one recording position versus time. And right now it's recording for 5 seconds. That's the default setting. If I decided to record an additional probe, I simply plug it into the Lab Pro. And in this case, I'm plugging in a temperature probe, and you'll notice the screen has changed, and it now has a graph to record temperature.
Why you would ever want to record temperature and motion, I don't know, but it's possible. You'll also notice down in the lower left-hand corner that there are what are called meters. These two boxes simply record whatever the probe is putting out right now. The motion detector has to be turned on to detect motion, so you get no reading there. But the temperature probe is automatically reading temperature, and you'll notice that it gives me the temperature. This is a useful tool even if you're not going to collect data over time. You simply plug in your temperature probe and students can read the temperature directly off the computer. If I warm up the temperature probe, you'll notice that the temperature begins to rise. So it offers real-time data collection in addition to recorded data collection. These are hot swappable probes, so I can simply take the temperature probe off and you'll notice that the software detects that there's no temperature probe and goes back to my position and velocity graphs. I'd like to show you some features of the LoggerPro software so that you can become familiar with the capability that we have with this equipment. While I want to stress how simple it is to collect data, there are a lot of parameters that we can change to determine how long we collect data, how many samples per minute, and that kind of thing. So let's look at the icon bar at the top of the screen, and you'll notice that there's a white sheet of paper. Like most software, it means this is a new page. What you see below the gray toolbar is referred to as a page. You can actually have multiple pages in an experiment so that you can have a data collection set up on one and another data collection set up on another one and then another. That's a nice feature to have if you had an ongoing experiment and you wanted different types of data collected. The next icon is an open file, and if you click on the open file, it automatically takes you to a folder on your computer called experiments. And in experiments, there are a number of file folders that have pre-designed setups. They have graphs that are specifically designed for a particular type of experiment. There are a whole set of middle school with computers experiments. If you click on the middle school with Vernier, you basically see the same stuff in it. That's for using with a calculator. The middle school with computers are experiments that are designed to work with middle school labs. We're going to be talking about a lab called the Hiker Lab from the Laying the Foundation training. Vernier has some similar labs and they're pre-set up and they're called Graphing Motion. And we will look at some of those a little bit later. The next icon is a save icon. Like any file, you can save these files or delete them. There's a printer icon for printing out the data. Since we don't have pages yet, the next couple of icons are grayed out because they're how you navigate from page to page. The next icon is a little more advanced. It's called the Show Hide Data Browser, and it determines what data is being collected over here on the left-hand side in the data chart. The next icon is about importing from the TI device. As I mentioned earlier, you can take the LabPro outside, collect data, bring it back in, plug it into your computer, and this icon lets you download that data just as if you had collected it live right there. The next icon has to do with auto-scaling the graph. Sometimes you'll collect data and all you see is a straight line, and it's because you're measuring distances of maybe half a meter, but the graph is set up to measure 100 meters. When you click auto-scale, it adjusts the graph so that your minimum and maximum match the minimum and maximum of the graph. This is a handy tool if you're collecting data and you're not seeing any signal. It could be that you're collecting data, but your scale is wrong. It's also a good tool to work with students talking about how we scale graphs to show different amounts of data. The plus, of course, is a zoom in. It's very similar to most programs that have a magnifying glass. You zoom in or zoom out using those. The next icons you're not going to use a whole lot in the middle school. These are statistical analysis tools. They allow you to find the tangent to a curve. They allow you to find the best fit line. They let you do statistical analysis of your curves. They find the area under the graph. And again, these are more sophisticated tools that we use in our high school physics classes. You're probably not going to use them much in the middle school. The first one, though, is called the Inspector. And what it does is it allows you to scroll along your data and get a readout of exactly what the data was at that point. So the Inspector is a tool that you might want to use if you're wanting to get specific data off a graph. The others, you're free to play with them, but they're probably not going to help you very much. The next icon opens a window that lets you control your data collection. When you open this window, you can decide whether it's a time-based or events-based or full spectrum. There's a whole bunch of options. The two that you're probably going to ever use are time-based and event-based. Time-based means you start the data collection and it collects continuously until the time runs out. Event-based means I want to start collecting data when something happens. Example would be if you wanted to detect or measure the pH in an aquarium during daylight hours. You could put a light probe into the aquarium or near the aquarium, put your pH probe in the aquarium, and then set it to be event-based, and it would trigger when light comes on and only record data when there's light. Again, it's not used that often, but it's one that you might use with motion and force activity. Sometimes you set it to collect data once an object reaches or passes a certain point or reaches a certain velocity. So that's what you might do with those. But mostly we're going to be time-based data. Length, how long do we want to collect data? In the hiker lab, we may be collecting data for a minute or a minute and a half. And right now it's set for 5 seconds. I can set this for milliseconds, seconds, minutes, and hours. And I can give it any number. So I'm going to change, just for the heck of it, I'm going to change this to 90 seconds, which is the same as 1.5 minutes. And I could put it in as 1.5 minutes. It'll take either one. It then asks whether I want to be able to repeat this and whether I want to take a sample right when I start. And in this case, probably not. That's not going to be a big issue. The next two boxes are kind of important, and that's how many samples per minute. In other words, how fast are you going to be taking samples, and how many minutes per sample. Now, the reason it's asking minutes is I had changed the top setting to minutes. I'm going to go back to seconds because when we're collecting data, we want our samples, and we could figure that out, we want our samples to be so many per second. So right now, we're set up to collect 20 samples per second and 0.5 seconds per sample. Those are really the inverse of each other, okay? I can change either one and it will change the other one. So I could change this to 10 samples per second and you'll notice that it automatically changes it to 0.1 seconds per sample. Does that make sense? If I want a sample every half second, I can put in 0.5 and it changes my sample rate to 2 samples per second. All right, so I can change either one of those to get the number of data points that I want. Since we're detecting motion, the motion is changing fairly rapidly, but you know, every half second probably would be fine. I'm going to change this to 4 samples per second, which gives us 4 data points every second. That should be fine enough for what we want. That gives us 360 samples. And, you know, you want to keep an eye on this. It's possible to get this into the millions of samples and you're going to have a huge file of data to deal with. So when you're setting up these parameters, the default parameters are kind of reasonable. But if you go in here and start changing these, you know, if you wanted to collect data for an hour and you wanted 10,000 samples per second, you'd have a data file that would probably fill your hard drive. So you want to make sure that these numbers are reasonable. Again, you don't really have to change these. The default is 6 seconds, 2 samples per second. I'm sorry, it's 5 seconds at 2 samples per second, which works for most things. It's probably not going to be long enough for the hiker lab, so you will need to lengthen the time that you're going to collect data. The next tab up, button up at the top is about triggering, and triggering is if I'm using trigger data, and we normally are not going to be doing that, but it's just another option that you'll see up there that you probably don't have to worry about. So once I've set up my data collection and I hit done, I'm ready to start collecting data. I always have the option of deleting my current data and starting over, or collecting data on top of what I've already done. So I'm going to clear my latest run, which clears the everything off. I'm going to auto scale, and for some reason it's still auto scaling at 5 seconds. Let me check this. Okay, it should be fine. And we're now ready to collect data. A couple more things I want to point out about the screen that we're working with is, because students will do this and they'll be confused and you'll need to be able to help them. Each of these white areas is a window, and I can move that window around. I can close this window. I can delete this window. So students, when they're working with the software, can also close, delete, get rid of windows, and they're going to be confused. The nice thing is, if I unplug the probes, plug it back in, it's going to recreate my windows because it knows what the probe is and it knows what data you're going to collect. So if a student happens to get rid of one of your windows or one of his windows and he gets confused, just plug the probe in and out. You might want to check your experiment parameters. It did default back to the 5 seconds, so I'm going to change that to 90. And it's collecting 20 samples per second. We'll leave that. That's 1,800 samples. Let's cut that down. I'm going to take that back down. All right. Now I'm ready to collect data using the Sonic Ranger. I want to talk to you a little bit about the motion detector. It has some characteristics that can cause problems in data collection if you don't understand what it does. This particular motion detector is the Motion Detector 2. Motion detector does fold open. And if you'll notice on the Motion Detector 2, there's a little switch. For what we're going to be using this for, you want the switch in the right-hand position where it has the person and the basketball. The other setting is for collecting data, rolling cars up and down ramps. And what it does is it changes the area that the detector picks up on. This detector sends out high-frequency sound waves, and the sound waves reflect off an object and bounce back. The detector can detect how long it took a particular pulse to reach the object and return, calculate the distance, and digitize it, send it into the computer. This is the same kind of echolocation that are used by dolphins, by bats, by submarines. In this case, we're using sound in air rather than sound in water, which our dolphin and submarines use. But it's the same principle. When the sound leaves this detector, just like most sounds, it spreads out. So a cone of sound is leaving the detector, and then a single reflection comes back. And what that means is that when you're using the detector, the more directly you are in front of it, the more likely it is to measure the object that's moving. If you get off to the side, it will detect something else. It might detect the ceiling in this case, rather than detecting my hand. Flat surfaces reflect better, so having a flat surface will give you a better return. So when you're using this, and students are using it, if they don't move or have objects moving directly up and down in front of it, or left and right in front of it, the detector will pick up other stuff. And so sometimes in the data charts, you'll see these spikes. And what that spike means is that the whatever was moving kind of got out of the way, and the sonic detector picked up something that was much farther away. So you need to caution your students. They need something that moves straight up and down in front of it. And the flatter the surface, the better the reflection. In the hiker lab, we're going to be having the students recreate a graph. In other words, they're going to have to read a graph, understand what it's telling them, and then use this motion detector to recreate that graph. So what they're going to want to do is set the motion detector with the sensor up on the edge of a table. You could use it here, but that cone is going to be hitting the surface of the table, and you're going to get some false reflections back. So moving it to the edge of the table will clean up that data for you. And then they're going to want a smooth surface. Yes, a student could stand here in front of it and move back and forth, but their bodies are not smooth. If they want to move their whole body,
they simply need to hold something like a box or a piece of paper, a cardstock, something that would give a smooth surface for the sonic detector to reflect from. When you plug in the Sonic Ranger, it will automatically default to the two position, the position and the velocity graph that you see on your screen. For the Hiker Lab from Laying the Foundation, you need a little bit different setup. We have a file available that you can open, and it's called, I've put it on my desktop, and you will put it wherever you want. It's called hikerlab.cmbl. The CMBL extension means it's a Logger Pro file. When you click on this, you will get a new graph that just has position, which is what the Hiker Lab is asking for, and it's preset for 90 seconds and a distance of approximately 2 meters. The challenge in the Hiker Lab is for students to recreate a graph that they're given using the sonic motion detector. And so this graph will allow them to do that. They're probably not going to be able to fill the entire graph. You need to stress with them what they're trying to reproduce is that line. And even if it doesn't fill the entire graph, they can change the scale if they want to eventually. So the first graph that the students are asked to replicate is a straight line going from the 0, 0 up at a diagonal straight as can be. Students may need to discuss what kind of motion would create that kind of line, looking at the relationship between position and time. I'm now going to demonstrate kind of how they can reproduce this graph with the motion detector. I'm going to use the Vernier Lab Pro box because it gives me a nice flat surface. I've positioned the motion detector on the edge of the table so that I don't get any bounce off the table. And I want to make sure that the sensor is directly up and down, especially in these motion detector tubes. They have a tighter beam, and if you're not careful, you can have it pointed down a little bit. And as you're collecting data, let's say you were moving the box back and forth like this, the beam may be going down, and when I get back to a certain point, it drops off and hits the floor. Now, in the situation we have here, if there's nothing in front of it, you get no signal because we're pointed at a wall at an angle. And so there's no flat surface to reflect it back. In a typical classroom, if you pointed this directly at a wall, you would constantly read that distance until you put something in there. So our data chart is going to be a little bit different because we are pointed at an angled wall rather than a flat wall. So I'm going to start with my box real close here, and the easiest thing for me to do is just to stand behind the box, and I'm going to get the data collection started, and I'm going to try to reproduce that graph. I can hear the clicking sound. That means that the motion detector is working, and to get the graph, the first graph that they're asked to reproduce, I move at a constant velocity away from the motion detector. It doesn't really matter how far I move. The point is I'm trying to recreate the graph. And if you look at the graph on the computer, you'll notice that I do have a straight line. It's a little steeper than the line that they're trying to reproduce. And here's where things like auto scale can come in. And I just auto scaled it so that now I see that it's, because I changed the scale, it's closer, much closer to what they were asked to reproduce on the lab. In addition to auto scaling, I have the ability to scale my graph simply by moving the axis. You'll notice on the vertical axis that my mouse pointer has turned into a squiggly line. And while it's a squiggly line with an arrow on both ends, it means I can move the axis up and down and move the graph up and down. If I move towards the top of the graph, you'll notice that it's a squiggly line with a flat on the bottom and an arrow on the top. And this means I can change the scale by pulling the top of the graph up and down. If I move to the bottom of the graph, it changes to a squiggly line and allows me to pull the scale of the graph up and down from the bottom. So if I really, really wanted to recreate the graph as seen on the paper, I can move the chart over. I'm moving the chart over at the bottom. Works exactly the same way. Then using the scaling from the top, I can pull it down. And lo and behold, I now have a graph that looks identical to the graph in the Laying the Foundation lab. So this ability to change the scale is very useful. Kids sometimes will happen on it before you even tell them about it, and they can get a little confused with what's going on here. But it allows you to change the scale of what you're looking at so that it fills your screen in addition to using the auto scale function. That's about all you need to know about the Laying the Foundation graph. There's a variety of curves, and it's quite a challenge for the students to figure out how to do some of these curves. The key thing on this activity is for them to analyze what the graph is telling them before they start moving. I do want to point out that along with your software, there are a whole series of experiments. And when you first launch Logger Pro, that's the default that comes up. But since I've been moving around on the computer, I have to go to the Logger Pro folder, go to the experiments folder, go to the middle school with computers. And if I scroll down to the bottom, there are a couple of what are called graphing motion experiments. I'm not going to save this data. And these are the same kind, set up for the same kind of activities that you just did. Another feature that's available on the Logger Pro, if I can remember where it is, yes, here it is. Experiment. Probably gonna have to cut this where, oh. Under analysis, there's something called draw prediction. And what draw prediction does is it lets students create, and this is hard to do with a touchpad, create a graph and challenge their fellow students to recreate it. So they literally can draw on the screen a graph, and again, it's hard to do with this mouse, and then challenge their fellow students to recreate the same graph. It's just an extension you can do, especially with your gifted students. That's about all there is using the sonic motion detector with Logger Pro.